No, they'll show up at 7:30.
I'd like to call to order the regular scheduled council meeting for Monday, May 16th, 2016, at 7 p.m. Mr. Collier.
Mayor Lowry.
Here.
Mr. McIntyre.
Here.
Mr. Reynolds.
Here.
Mr. Lindsay.
Here.
Mr. McLaughlin.
Here.
Mr. Kraybocker.
Here.
That's my voice.
Six members present.
Thank you, sir. All right, so Stan will have the invocation tonight by Councilman Lowell McLaughlin.
I want to stand, please. Lord, thank you so much for allowing us all to be together. Thank you for this beautiful city that we have, that we are working on to make it a better place for all of us to live. We thank you for our health. Thank you for the weather. We've had enough rain for a little bit. Let it sun a little more. And again, thank you for allowing us on this council and for all of you that are attending. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Amen.
Thank you. We'll use the flag in the back tonight for the pledge.
The pledge of allegiance is to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic from which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Action on the minutes for regular meeting of May 2nd, 2016.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? No.
Okay. Mr. Collier, Mr. McLaughlin?
Yes.
Mr. Kraybocker?
Yes.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Passed 6-0.
Thank you, sir. Also, before we move on, if anybody has any symptoms, please turn them down from that library, please. We'd appreciate that. All right, moving on for communications tonight. We have a proclamation for Lowell McLaughlin, former mayor of New Carolina.
Mr. McLaughlin,
would you like me to join?
Yes, I would.
I'd be happy to.
April, I know you have a good camera. Would you take a photo, please, for Mr. McLaughlin here?
April, you're doing awesome. You're straight.
Good. All right. Proclamation for Mr. McLaughlin here tonight. Proclamation of appreciation honoring the public service work of former mayor of New Carlisle, Lowell McLaughlin. Sorry, it's a tongue twister. I apologize. Whereas Lowell McLaughlin was born and raised in Clark County area, and whereas Mr. McLaughlin has been a City of New Carlisle council member for 14 years, 4 years of which he was dedicated to being a great and effective mayor of the city, and whereas Mr. McLaughlin has a long record of public service before being selected as a City of New Carlisle councilman or mayor, and whereas Mr. McLaughlin has been a Clark County business owner for 30 years, a member of the New Carlisle Rotary for 23 years, a member of the Masonic Lodge for 15 years, a member of the American Legion Post 286 for 28 years, member of the Clark County Transportation Coordinating Committee for 5 years, a member of the Western Clark County Business Coalition for 4 years, and member of the Heritage of Light Festival Committee for 12 years, to name a few. Is there any more we forgot?
I thank somebody for doing that. That's awfully nice.
That's impressive. And whereas Mr. McLaughlin is an honored veteran and has served his country while in the Marine Corps, and whereas Mr. McLaughlin has traveled the world over bringing valued culture experience to our great city, and whereas service to others is a hallmark of the American character and central to how we meet our challenges, and whereas the nation's mayors are increasingly asked to turn to volunteerism as a cost-effective strategy to meet needs, and whereas the City of New Carlisle wishes Mr. McLaughlin the best of luck as he embarks on his next professional stage of his life and seeking election to becoming a Clark County Commissioner. Now, therefore, I, Mike Lowry, Mayor of the City of New Carlisle, Ohio, recognition for Mr. Lowell McLaughlin serving as the City of New Carlisle Mayor from January 2012 to December of 2015, do hereby honor his tremendous work with a sincere thanks for his service to our community and gifting his his gavel used during his mayoral tenure. Thank you, sir.
I'm glad he had to read it, not me, that's all.
That was a long one. Congratulations, sir.
You got a proclamation.
Before we move on, any comments for Mr. McLaughlin before we move on? No? All right, thank you very much, Lowell, for everything.
You're welcome.
I'm just going to call you Lowell because you've done so much for the city and you're a great guy.
Appreciate it, thank you.
All right, moving on to city manager's report, Mr. Bridge.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of council, members of the public. I'd like to share with you the city manager's report. There is no discussion under major projects. We'll just jump into our finance report with our finance director, Mrs. Harris.
Thank you, Mr. Bridge, Mayor, Council, and members of the public. Got the April financial report. Total revenue for the month of April was $585,044.62. And those of you looking at my report, my typo there, that February is supposed to say April. Total April expenses is $324,123.51. So our year-to-date collected revenue is $2,117,985.81. And our year-to-date expenses is $1,207,994.87. And I'm still putting in the income tax numbers. So our general fund collected for the month of April, the income tax at $231,138.25. The half percent police income levy brought in $119,154.49. For a total for the month of April for the income tax, we brought in $350,292.74. So our year-to-date in the general fund for our income tax is $539,318.60. And the police levy has brought in $251,069.40. That is the cover sheet. Is there any questions I can?
Council, any questions?
Are we running ahead of last year or? Well, discount the police levy, of course.
Yes, we're running ahead
otherwise.
And we still have a lot of tax returns that are not receipted. They're all date stamped, so they were credited for when they were turned in, but we are still doing data entry for those. So next month's revenue is still going to show quite high, and then it'll start slowing down.
Thank you.
Thanks, sir. Mr. Lindsay.
I see on here there's some repairs to the medic. For the ambulance, what was wrong with that?
You'll probably need to talk with the fire chief on what broke on it. I don't have the details with me. I have the expense from the accounts payable.
Right. The only other comment I have on the check register,
mm-hmm.
I know you have some checks here that doesn't, most of the checks it tells us what the check was for.
Mm-hmm.
Could we do that on like the rest of the checks? I know the income tax refund, that's pretty self-explanatory. But I mean, on checks for expenses, could we get some type of
I do it manually. If it's a consensus that everybody, most of these are monthly, I didn't put them in. I'd be glad to do whatever the consensus of council would like.
Just council, keep in mind that the finance department is severely understaffed. So my recommendation would be to, if you see a few in there that you want to know about, let us know, and then we'll get back to you on that. But Ms. Harris has already got her hand to play full. It is something that we could definitely work with you on.
It doesn't come out automatic.
Yeah.
It's all going back in manually. But I do have a report I bring. I can get you a detail if there's something else.
Oh, okay. That would work.
Okay. So is there a particular question on one?
No, I mean, I was just reading through it, and you know, you have down here Horton Emergency Services. It's only less than $37. The Doolittle, I think is how you pronounce it, Oxygen Company, Is that for like settling or something for the hut or?
That's oxygen to burn.
Oxygen to burn for a settling torch?
Sure.
Yeah, okay. Some of them I could kind of figure it out, but you know, I'm just curious as what some of them other ones are. That's all.
Mr. Bridge?
Oh yeah, let me get back to my page here, sorry about that. And moving on, our service director, Mr. Kitko, is out today. I do have some updates for him, so I'm just gonna read the email that he sent me. The first one is Edgebrook. The Edgebrook project is ongoing. 50% of the curb replacement is complete. Willowick drainage issues. I know Mr. Reynolds, you had questioned what's going on at Willowick Park with the drainage underneath. Storm structures were found very deteriorated and are not repairable. So we're currently pricing the new structure and piping. Now it's not as big as once originally thought it was. I think it's like a 12 by 12 actually shaft opposed to a 12 foot monster.
60 foot.
Yeah. So we'll get, as soon as we get new pricing on that, we'll definitely update council. Prentice Drive, here's actually some good news. We have submitted the block grant money since we chose not to do the school route to go in for Prentice 3. Mr. Kitko's been talking with Mr. Harris out the county. He deals with the block grant monies. So the county also suggested that we submit for phase 3 and phase 4 critical infrastructure grant to try to get the rest of Prentice done in one shot. You know, so again, we have to wait for the award period to come out. If we get that granted to us, we're going to take full opportunity and get that money and get Prentice just done. Hopefully to make everybody a little more happier up there.
That's awesome.
And that's all he had in his report. I'd be happy to field any questions. If I don't have any answers, we'll definitely get back to you on that.
I got it's on Edgebrook. I don't know if you can answer this question.
Sure.
Okay. I drove down it the other day. It says, you know, through, you know, local traffic only. Mm-hmm. So I drove it. Is there going to be a point there, a time that it's going to be blocked off, it's going to be closed, or one half of it's going to be closed?
I think they'll probably do half at a time. Don't quote me on that. But I'll shoot you an email, or I'll have Mr. Kitko shoot me an email tomorrow with that question. So you just want to know the delay schedule, if any.
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mr. Reynolds.
So with that, the Willow Park with that little shaft, or the giant shaft that's in there, are they going to like tear it out and just put a new one in, or are they just going
to? I think they're looking to, they're going to have to tear it out, yes.
Yeah, because it's like a giant bunker. Like, it's huge.
Yeah, well, this one's not as big as we thought it was.
Okay.
It's not like the wide base. It's more of a, almost like a tall cylinder type deal. So they're going to replace that, and there's a big old thick steel plate that goes on top of it. So you won't be able to access it.
All right, fantastic. So I'm just worried about someone getting in there, and now you said it's deteriorating. I don't want to collapse in on somebody.
It's almost like you have to go there, visually see it, because it's hard to kind of explain.
Oh, yeah.
But it is a safety issue. We need to get it fixed.
Oh.
Yep.
Thank you.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Lindsay.
I noticed on North Henry, I don't have the address, they have a cone there where the street had caved in by one of the sewer water drainage things.
It was a hole in the road.
What is it called?
Yeah. Yeah, right.
What's it called?
Well, it's a storm sewer.
Storm sewer, okay. They've got a cone sitting there. And the cone's about this far down the ground now, so I think it's continuing to sink. And while you're thinking about that question, could you forward the information on Richard?
I have it in my to-do folder. He will have that soon enough.
Okay.
Yep.
Did you see the photo? I mean,
it looks like the street was done and a heavy truck came and went to go and moved all that warm some black top in it. And bunch it up.
Yeah,
that's the only thing I can see what it looks like. Yeah.
Looks like somebody dumped blacktop on it. But you can see the tracks in the road, too.
Sure. Thank you for sending me the picture, by the way.
You're welcome.
Mr. McLaughlin.
The speed sign that we put out on the north side of town on 235, do we have our own, or was that one from the sheriff's department?
I asked Mr. Kitko about that. He wasn't sure if it was our own or if we got it from the county, so we are looking into that.
Because I know it was out for a while, but we've taken it.
I want to say that was a loaner from the county. Don't quote me on it. I don't think we have a second one of those in our arsenal. I could be wrong. But we can always reach back out and get that place back up there. And you said you wanted it up by Haddocksfield,
correct? It slowed traffic down for a while, but now that it's gone, of course, it's speed up again.
When was it out there last?
Probably last Friday, I think, was the last time that I saw it there. It was down there at the point.
Are you guys placing that down there?
We put it down there.
You put it down there?
So it is the sheriff's.
It is the sheriff's.
Okay, thanks, Sergeant.
We picked it up Friday and moved it to a different location. If we can get it back up here, we will.
Okay.
Especially knowing it was a deterrent.
Any other questions? Okay, Mr. Bridge?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Moving on with the planning and zoning discussion, just got some basic numbers for you guys. Code enforcement number, tall grass, Mr. Clark issued 41 violations. We also had 5 trash violations go through, 3 other violations that have been rained, that could probably ranging from parking on unapproved surface to, maybe having a fence too tall or a hedge too tall in your front yard. Also, he issued 10 yellow tags, which are just essentially warnings. If you get a yellow tag on your property, on your door, that means you have 5 days to correct the problem before we go ahead and put that to official violation. Also, and this does need a motion to approve through council. Planning board did approve on May 12, 2016, a lot split at 214 South Pike and 435 North Main Street. So that lot split is in there. In years past, this planning board, have you guys approved planning board lot splits?
It changed.
Yeah.
It changed?
I think if there was a problem from the planning board and someone came, then it would come to us.
Okay.
But otherwise, the planning, if they passed it,
you're good.
Sorry with them, it was
okay.
Good.
So it does not need a motion to approve
it. It didn't in the past.
I don't think so. What I remember is if, like you said, if there was a problem that we thought that they didn't maybe consider.
They have appeal power through you guys, is what
right.
They have.
Right.
Gotcha. Okay. Fire and EMS report. The report is attached. We did have a car wreck on North Main Street, so our fire chief might not be able to make it today. So look over that report. If you have any questions, just shoot me an email and I'll get them to Chief Trusty. Just in case anybody's wondering, we had a minivan strike a building doing some structural damage. So I'm sure he's still on scene there.
Mr. Bridge,
Mr.
McIntyre, I had a question on planning.
Sure.
Mr. Bridge, I had a question about grass cutting. I'm going to speak in hypotheticals because I'm still gathering information and I don't want to mention a party or an address or something when it may not be completely accurate. So,
sure.
But I know there was a property in which the grass was getting tall and it was recently cut and the clippings from the yard were placed on the street by whatever party did it. I'm not sure if this was a city entity, I trust it wasn't, or a bank which had cut it. I was wondering if it were to be a bank that repossessed the house and cut the grass and then they placed the clippings onto the street, which involved basically the entire neighborhood coming together to shovel the stuff so it wouldn't blow all over, the world. Is this a situation where we could go to the bank or call them and say, hey, you guys, maybe we can handle this a bit differently? Because I'm assuming that's some sort of a pollution violation or littering.
It does. It goes across many spectrums of violations. The big thing when you put your grass clippings in a street like that, it goes into our storm sewer system. And that can cause a lot of havoc.
Yeah.
And then, too, you got the wind factor that it blows everything around. And it blatantly states in our codes and actually on the violation form when you get it for high grass that you are to remove all grass clippings. What we can do is we can find out what house it is. If it is bank owned, a lot of these bank owned properties have local companies that manage them for them.
Sure.
Safeguard Properties is one of them. We can contact them. A lot of them just don't know what they can and can't
right.
do. So we can try to alleviate the issue that way first. If it keeps on going on, we'll turn around and even though the grass is cut, we can still violate them for having the clippings present on the property.
Sure. So I'll find out the information that was passed along to me and I will be able to get that to you and
yeah.
we can work on that. Thank you.
No problem.
Mr. McLaughlin.
My question also is about grass cutting and so forth.
Mm-hmm.
The abatement, that are we doing it for the city or have we hired somebody to come in?
Oh, that is back in house. I brought that back
in house.
We have it in house
now
mm-hmm.
because then we won't have to wait to get our money.
Well,
I mean, we have to pay money out that we may not get until the property sells.
Well, they still get assessed the same way. How we did it before is we contracted out with a company out of Springfield. They charge us $35-$40 to do the lawn. Well, we actually will get more money in return if we do it in-house. If we do it in-house, then we do an administrative fee, a disposal fee, then we also have a per hour, per man fee.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't want people to think that we're just price gouging citizens. These are people who don't cut their grass. And usually 9 times out of 10, it's a vacant building, meaning it's bank owned. But we're going to see more on our return if we keep it in our house.
Thank you.
Sure. Now, with that being said, Twin Creeks is still contracted out to cut.
Okay.
Because it's just too many things for our guys to try to keep up on.
Mr. Kirkland, one word, sidewalks.
Manpower.
Money.
But you said you were training Jim to do that, that's why.
Well, we gotta get, right now is a grow season for grass, so let's wait till June or July when that comes out a little bit, then we'll have to reassess the situation. But until we get more bodies in our seats, we're gonna have a hard time doing these big projects. When I did the sidewalk repair and I was the planning director, it took most of my time, if not all.
So, there's nothing you can hire somebody part-time or student or go around to do your measuring or?
No, yeah, but we already did the budget for this year. So it's not like we just get more money out of nowhere and be like, let's hire somebody in. I understand the sidewalks.
It's a safety issue.
Well, I understand that.
It's a safety issue.
I understand that. Sidewalks have been in that condition for like some time. I'm not trying to make excuses. It comes down to manpower. That's what it comes down to.
Yeah, I made a comment to you earlier, you know, about the house on Madison. They put a roof on it today, so.
Yeah.
And I like to, I want to see what the inside smells like, so.
Now, I have every intention on hiring a full-time planning director in January. So we'll see what to reanalyze then. I think we're not having a planning director, we're missing key components. One of that is, well, the big one's economic development, customer service to our citizens is another one. And then these special projects that we just don't have the manpower to go out and do stuff like that. Having a part-time code enforcement officer.
Mr. Reynolds.
I had a quick question. It's about the mowing. Mm-hmm. So is that $35 just to mow, or is that hourly rate? Is it cheaper to have to outsource it? Because either way, we don't get that money until the lot is sold, no matter what we do.
Mm-hmm.
So is it cheaper on the city to outsource or to do in-house?
We get it charged. We get $35 for $40.
Hourly or
just
period?
One period for them to go out and do it.
And do you know how long it would take, a lot like Twin Creeks, you know how long it would take a city employee?
Well, Twin Creeks is contracted out.
Okay, so that is.
We're talking about our normal abatements.
So like normal.
The downside of that is when we contracted out, like last year and the year before, it could be another 14 days before they can get to doing it. At least if we do it in-house, it's done within a day or two.
All right. Just was wondering, because I know, like, I don't want to be spending a lot of money, you know, on these things that.
Well, it's not. It's your labor hours. You're not really spending money.
And then another. Well, we're still spending money because they're working on it. But another big point. I've brought this up a few times. We talked about it. Is, I don't know if we're working on it at all. Is Cincinnati, Athens, all these cities are taking these banks that or these Harbor Link groups and all these realty groups that own all these vacant properties aren't doing anything with them. They're taking them to court because they're not paying because they're just putting it on the back taxes. And, you know, once you get big assessment back taxes, no one's going to buy the house, and then it becomes unmarketable, and then it falls in on itself and just does terrible things. So have we looked at that any further? I know manpower, right, is a big key.
More manpower, but that would fall under our legal department, and you're looking at Lynette's fees shooting up.
Well,
I mean, I don't have the legal authority to take somebody to court for the CD New for a while. That comes all out. That's Lynette.
Well, yeah. Well, I mean, we spent a ton last year, so, I mean, we budgeted, right? So. We budget, why not spend it?
I think there's more important things to use the money on, like Kennedy Trust.
Well, I agree, but we're moving away from all this stuff slowly, as the ordinance today. But until then, I think definitely
Kennedy Trust is separate than what
we're doing. Oh, yeah, sure. Well, I'm saying different things. You know, mm-hmm. Jimmy Creek is slowly becoming less of an issue.
Sure.
So, but.
No, I get you. It's something that we need to work on in the pipeline.
Oh, yeah.
We just, it comes down to manpower. It comes down to hours.
I totally agree.
You know, I think once we're out of the having lack of manpower and have a little more money in the general fund, I think you can look at doing these kind of things. Cincinnati, they got a lot more in their pockets than we do.
Athens as well.
Yeah, it's tough, you know. So, but it comes down to cost and benefit. We know everybody in this room wants a great city. We all want one that looks fantastic, beautiful. What's the reality with what we're working with? And that's where we're at.
Oh, yeah.
You know?
Oh, yeah. I mean, manpower's the key.
But I thought it was a good idea when you brought it up, and I still think it's a good idea.
Like, you know, these banks don't care about New Carlisle. They don't care about us out here. They care about making money. They could care less about if it gets mowed or if it doesn't get mowed. Because mm-hmm. they're never going to pay it, because it just gets assessed to the property, and they're never going to sell the property to begin with. So they're like, oh, cut off.
Well, I think it depends on the quality of the house. So the house is in decent shape. Like the West Madison one with the $2,000 or $3,000, the one where they came to the council, we had to go clean it up. That bank's already is getting in the process of paying that.
Good.
So it depends. Now, if you see a house in Prentice that's been vacant for 15 years and it's getting ready to fall over,
yeah,
those are the houses, excuse me, that they're not doing anything with.
Yeah.
You know, so it's like,
I don't want anyone to get to that point. That's my fear, is just to let them just continue to go, and then we get to that point where we have so many vacant houses that...
And another thing when it comes to this too, and I didn't stop it, but I thought about it. We can put all this money into doing these houses. For example, 228 Gelwood, we have taken care of that property. I know when I started as a planning director, we were cutting that grass. That went to sheriff's sale. As soon as that goes to sheriff's sale, all past nuisance abatements for cutting grass are gone. So we lost it. So you gotta watch how much you put in these houses that have been vacant for years upon years. Because as soon as you go to keep it up and make it look nice every single week, as soon as it goes to sheriff's sale, you gotta take it all off.
Yeah.
You know, so that's another thing that I'm trying to balance. Like, what's that balance between putting money into it so your neighbors don't have to suffer versus how much we're gonna lose once that goes to sheriff's sale? So it's a sticky situation when it comes to these abatements. It really is. Mm-hmm. Sure.
It's rough.
Mr. Bridges, also on the same subject he was talking about, and maybe you'd touch on this before when you were planning director, when a city goes to court, say with a bank, or tries to pursue those types of things, is it possible to even win against these big banks, or can they tie, I mean, in your experience, can they just keep tied up?
We have never taken anybody to court over here. I tell you right now, most small places like this don't touch it. Uh-huh. It's cheaper for them just to let it go.
We can't afford it.
They can't afford it. I mean, if they appeal once, that's another set of, I don't know how many hours it takes, that 160, whatever fee we're being charged for the legal at that point in time. We got that hourly cost. We have the mileage cost to go into and from court. So it's just like, unless your city has deep pockets,
the bank can essentially keep dragging it on.
They can. I want an extension. I want this. I want that. And that costs money every single time they do it.
Okay. Thank you, Mr.
I had a follow-up to Mr. Krabacher's question about sidewalks. I understand the manpower issue. Is one of the manpower problems we have having people to go through and mark or locate sidewalks that are in disrepair? Is that a large part of the problem?
It's going out. It's first identifying. It's getting all the letters written. It is following up. It is the database administration once people start to do it. It is a time-intensive thing. Has great results. I'm not saying it didn't. It did fantastic results. But I'm telling you, when I did as a planning director, that's all I did for probably a month.
Would it be advantageous to check with some of the local universities and see if they have like a public administration student that needs a practicum over the summer, and maybe we can convince them to...
Well, I'm not trying to say no to everything you do. But when it comes to, because I went through that whole program too, they're not going to let one student just come up to do a sidewalk assessment for a project.
I was hoping they would.
You're going to have a way more intricate, involved. If I brought somebody in like that, it would be, hey, I need you to update our comprehensive land use plan. They need something that has a lot more substance than just walking around saying, this is cracked an inch, this is it, is this a 1, 2, or 3, move on.
Sure.
You know, I have every intention in starting that back. It's just a matter of when.
No, I understand. Sure. Thank you.
Mr. Bridge, when you're ready.
All right.
Thank you.
No problem. And moving on with the city manager's report, our police discussion with Sergeant Underwood.
Thank you very much. I picked up the wrong folder tonight.
Police discussion is on hold until June 2nd.
We'll get us an out email, and I'll have copies up here, the report tomorrow. I'm going to... as much as I can remember, I will give to you. I did notice this month our reports, we had a 81 or 82 reports. I know New Carlotta had 48 of those. And that's typically what we take in a month, is about 48. So we've increased our reports, which means maybe crime's on the rise, maybe not. But more people are reporting to us also. Some reports we take are not criminal. They're just incident reports. We've had several domestic violence, I know that. And I won't get into numbers. We did have one OVI and one charge last month. But what I do want to tell you is, and I want to really stress that school's going to be out in a couple weeks, and we're going to have to change our driving habits. We've been very kind to the people of New Carlisle. We're asking you again, please slow down. Please stop at the stop signs. Don't roll through them. We're gonna have our youth out here, and they expect you to stop, not to roll through. they're playing, going to be not paying the attention that they probably should. So especially if you see a group of children playing in the street or on the road or close to it on the sidewalk, please be cautious. Please slow down. You have the right to do the speed limit, but you have a responsibility too. If you think there's an issue close by and you can be a part of that issue, for all means, please slow down. So those are our two biggest issues in New Carlisle, our stop signs and speeding. And we can't be every place all the time. So I'm going to encourage our young deputies out here to start writing citations. Let's prepare for the summer. Along with that, we sent Deputy Allender and Deputy Cruz to bike school last week. It was Dayton Metro bike unit they went to. They did a great training. It's very rigorous. It's a difficult training. They have bruises and lumps all over them. And we was able to refurbish the bikes that we had. So they were able to take those. We saved a little bit of money there. Probably in the next couple of years, if we want to keep this, we're going to have to invest in a couple good bikes. And a good police bike, cheap end, $600, expensive end, whatever you want to pay. Hopefully, we'll get started on this and work the bugs out. Now, Deputy Cruz was injured. She has an injury to her wrist, and she will be back to work Friday. It was her gun hand, and we don't want to take any chances. So the doctor told her she needs to stay off until Friday. So we're dealing with that. She completed her training. She went up, the last day was a firearms practice, and where they actually do maneuvers on their bicycle, self-defense maneuvers, and they hop over a few things, and they're told how to position their bikes if they get in a shooting situation. And it's real good training. I went through this in the late 90s. It's the best class I had attended as far as cars or motorcycles or bikes or whatever. But it is a hard training. So we'll get her back, get her patched up, and hopefully we will be seeing them on bicycles soon. I do know that the Clark County Sheriff's Office, I believe we did a news release today with Lieutenant Barnhart and Rachel Allender, and so that might be even be on the news tonight. We're working on a uniform. We thought we had what was necessary. Lieutenant Barnhart had attended the training and found out that all of the departments that were there were outfitted just about the same. So we want to try to be in line with them, and actually to be less expensive for us, and to look really good. So I was excited about that. So that should be coming up real soon. Hopefully you'll be seeing them soon. Also, Lieutenant Barnhart will be writing a policy on the bikes, trying to keep things updated there. And unfortunately, you know, just down the road from us, last week we had a fatality. And it was a young person in the vehicle with a parent, and there was a person killed. It was on a motorcycle. I ride motorcycles, have a lot of friends that ride motorcycles, and some people don't like them. They're too noisy, too small, too hard to see. It's cheap transportation, a lot of people are on them. So please be careful. It's hard sometimes when a motorcycle pulls up to a stop sign and people are stopping at the last second. It's hard to figure out if they're going to stop or not. So you should be constantly looking. We should also on motorcycles. So just as a reminder, please help it make it safe for all of us. And you don't want to be involved in a crash anyhow, and especially a severe injury or maybe even a fatality. That's a nightmare to go through. And I will get that report to you. There is more into it. The sheriff actually did a detailed report about crime stats. That's also there with it, and it's in color too. So it'll give you a real opportunity to see what is going on, not just in New Carlisle, but the whole community. And Beller's still leading the stats. So he's doing pretty good. And those that don't know who Deputy Beller is, he worked up here for quite some time, and now he's stationed out at the East Office in Springfield for the Sheriff's Office. He's working first shift, and he's up here a lot, so if you see him, just tell him hi. I'm sure he'd appreciate that. He's currently leading our stats for traffic at the time being. With that said, I'll open it up for any questions. If you have any.
Counsel. Mr. McIntyre.
Sir, I understand your deputies had a pretty busy weekend. I just want to thank them for the professionalism. We've had a lot of instances of people stealing, and I think they're getting a little bit more brazen because a group of citizens were able to rally and stop what was going to be a daytime robbery of some equipment in New Carlisle. And so I was really happy to see both citizens coming out and doing their best to inform law enforcement and stop the incident from happening, and also the professionalism with which your deputies responded and were able to take care of the situation. And so just to pass along my sincere thanks.
I certainly will, thank you.
And are these daytime robberies, is this something we're seeing more, are they getting more and more brazen, or is it just happen to be these folks?
We had the same thing happen a couple of years ago, and we caught the two young men. Maybe they released them, I don't know. But usually it's a couple that do the daytime stuff. But daytime robberies or home invasions take place all over the county. So sometimes we see more in the day than we do in the evening. And I can't tell you the reason. And generally, these type of people aren't so much checking your home out in advance, it's just an opportunity. They see something opportune. Someone may leave the garage door open. You might throw something out the curb, the big box that your 55-inch TV come in. Okay, that's telling you have a new one in the house. They look for things like that. And we're very successful on catching. It just takes us some time. So the most important thing with you for us is you're really our eyes and ears, and you've heard me say that before. Don't hesitate. If you think something's wrong, call us. And as soon as we can, we'll check it out.
Thank you. Sergeant Underwood, I'm going to kind of carry over what Mr. McIntyre was talking about. I had to have the New Carlisle Fire Department come out to my house last week to check for a natural gas possible leak. Everything was clear, but they did a great job with it too, Randy. They were on it, very professional. But while we were sitting there after they had finished up, I was talking to Mr. Ritter and a couple of the other guys and asked them how their relationship was with the three girls, because I know the newer deputy we have, he's still a little new, so they may not have a relationship quite with him yet. But he said the other three, he says they are the best group of girls to work with. He said that when they're not busy and New Carlisle department goes out on a run, if they're not busy, they'll follow them to the scene of the incident and make sure that they're not needed. He said that they're phenomenal to work with. So I just wanted to pass that along as well.
Thank you. That's good to hear. We probably have the youngest group of deputies up there that we've ever had and up here now. And that's good because they're eager to learn and they're jumping in and taking on tasks that they haven't seen yet. They're making phone calls to supervisors, and that's a good thing.
Sounds like they're, even though they're the younger group, they are making a good footprint already, so that's,
yeah, I'm glad
that's
to hear
really
that.
Good. Any other questions? Mr. McLaughlin.
If the speed sign's not being used by the county, could it be put out here again?
Yes. If we have a vacant spot, I know we have it for the next probably week and a half tied up, but we have nothing after that. If something didn't come in, I'll get it up here.
Maybe we could ask our deputies where they think it might be needed, you know, where they are seeing speed, that maybe we could slow it down.
Okay, we can put it at the other end of town.
We have one south, and we have one on 571.
Are they functional, though?
They're functional, both of them. Maybe Lake Avenue or down by the pool, might be.
I'll call the city manager before we bring it up, and you can have some input on where you would like to see it.
Did you by chance get the new cruiser out, or still got that on scene?
Yeah, it's still on the scene.
Okay.
I thought the chief was going to come in. That's a serious damage to that building. The roof had buckled from one end to the other on the top. The west wall is heavily damaged. The back of it is damaged. We spent a lot of time there trying to put everything exactly where it should be. The fire department was great, helping us block everything off and making sure it was safe. We did remove the vehicle from it, and someone is coming out tonight to try to do the best they can to make sure it doesn't collapse. It doesn't look like there's any danger in that, but that's going to be a very expensive repair. There was a young lady with her father that had a driving permit, and it looks like she hit the gas instead of the brake. That's unfortunate. She wasn't injured. I seen her, they were patching up one of her fingers. The airbags kept them from serious injury. And I don't know the exact speed they hit the building at, but it wasn't a tremendous fast crash. It was just a solid. Hit the brakes too late, hit the gas first, and then the brakes. So that's unfortunate. You're looking at Scissor Hands. What's the first name?
Susie.
Yeah. So that's the business, and it looks like it's going to be closed for a while.
So what you're trying to tell me is I will not get my hair cut this week.
I'll do that on the side.
Okay. Thanks, Sergeant.
Okay. Perfect timing, Chief.
Yeah, I did. I was waiting on you, and then I told the story.
Tristan, yeah, for me. Mr. Bridge, we want to press in for some breaking information while he's here.
Yeah, you want to do your report?
Yeah.
Scaled the building?
Yeah. Ropes, everything. Mayor, council, and citizens. The month of April, New Carlisle Fire Division responded to 84 EMS calls in the city, 11 in Elizabeth Township. The division responded to 10 fire-related calls in the city and 3 in Elizabeth Township. We had 3 EMS calls answered by mutual aid, either with Pike Township or Bethel Clark Township, due to Medic 1 already be on a response, Medic 52. We have our annual hose testing set for the May 24th, and the SCBA testing, in which I've gone out today, will be June 6th. The division received a $1,100 donation from the Church of the Brethren. They took up a special collection for us all through the season of Lent. That donation will go towards the fundraiser that we're having this year to purchase the Lucas tool for Medic 52. That was a really tremendous, tremendous thing for us. That's something we did not expect. It's greatly appreciated by the division, by everyone in the division. It was really, really a fantastic thing for us. This past couple weeks, we spoke with the city manager about this. In the fire service, you have times when it's just really crappy days or crappy weeks in the fire service. This past couple weeks, the division had a few really crappy days. We had 4 overdose calls in 4 days. 3 of them we were able to revive, when we were not, which ended up with a double death due to the patient being pregnant. And then you have that one call that makes everything okay. Now we know why we're doing this job. Last Tuesday night, our EMS crew out of Elizabeth Township was toned out about 10:30, 11 o'clock at night for a middle-aged female that was experiencing chest pain, shortness of breath. Medic crew got there. The patient was kind of, I really don't want to go to the hospital. I think I'm going to be okay. Our medic that was on the scene, Jen Jordan, had that, you get those gut feelings as a medic or a firefighter. She had that gut feeling, no, this ain't good. Kept talking to her, finally got her talked into going to the hospital and asked which hospital, you know, she normally wanted to go to, and she said Upper Valley. And they got a medic, and with the new LifePath 15 that we showed you, medic 3 also has one on it. They did a 12-lead EKG on her, and the EKG showed kind of, you know, nothing really bad, but it was fine. So they started heading toward Upper Valley, and the medic's like, nah, this is still, I'm just not happy. And I'm gonna do another 12-lead. She reached over to do the 12-lead, hit it. The life pack went off, full alerts. The life pack called her right as she was having a major heart attack. The medic immediately called the hospital, put out for a cardiac alert, which means the whole hospital, everybody for cardiac comes to the ER. By the time they got to Upper Valley, care flight was inbound. They medevaced her to Good Samaritan, did surgery on her the next morning, and she came through the surgery flying colors. She's doing fine. And then the kind of icing on top of the cake was the next morning I called the head trustee for Elizabeth Township, Greg Dilt, to let him know, because he always wants to know those type of calls. And he goes, yeah, I know. It was my aunt.
Yeah.
You know, and those type of calls that, you know, you step back and say, okay, now I know why I'm doing this job. Both those two people on that crew will be receiving letters of recognition from the division for the job and the outstanding, you know, care that they gave that patient. You know, it's one of those things when you get those good outcomes, like we did with that and like we did with the other three ODs that we ran, it makes a big difference. And just as of today, one of our firefighters just graduated Emergency Medical Technician School. He is now a certified EMT. And that will give me, at this point, 1, 2, 3, 4 paramedics that live in the city. And that will give me 4 EMT firefighters that live in the city limits.
Good.
So things are definitely going in the right direction.
Great. Thank you very much, sir. Council, any questions or comments? Mr. Craybacher.
Mr. Lindsay asked a question earlier, so I might as well ask you, because I was going to ask the same question. We show that there was a medic unit that was towed. You know, is it okay?
It's probably from one of the gentlemen right there. May I go for you? So that's repaired today, huh?
We had old medic unit repaired.
Bain's towed was who we made the check out to.
Oh, that's because they did the repairs. Right. It was never towed. It was never out of service. No. The reason Maine's is the only one in this area that can do the painting and the striping that the medic or a fire engine requires to have done to it. They're more or less a specialty at it, and they were the only ones that the insurance adjuster would contract to do the repair of the medic. But it was never out of service. It was more of a cosmetic repair than anything else.
Okay.
It was from one of the employees.
Yeah, that's one of the employee. What it was, we had a call. It was at night to 1218 Lake, the retirement community. Mm-hmm. And the call came in as a patient down beside the garage. If you pull in 1218, there's garages over on this side of the structure. When they came in, they made that turn to go down by there. And the parking that they have there is not correct. If they have parking spaces, and if someone's parked in those parking spaces, the person literally cannot back out of their garage. And when they made that cut to go in to the scene, they got a little bit too close and caught the eave of the structure.
Okay, good.
Mr. Lindsay?
How much damage did it cause to the structure then?
The structure, I'm not really for sure, because under Ohio state law, if a vehicle is responding to or on scene of an accident, they are not liable for damages to a structure.
Okay. And it was no just paint damage like to the medic?
They probably had to replace a piece of guttering and a little bit of faucet.
Say that one more time, sir.
They had to replace a little bit of the guttering and faucet, probably.
Okay, thank you.
Council, any other questions or comments? Mr. McLaughlin.
I just want to thank the whole department for all the good work. Thank you. We appreciate it. Sounds like things are right where we would all love to have them. We're doing a great job. Thank you.
Getting a lot of recognition. We really are. The Rotary Club They've decided to recognize one firefighter from every department in the area, and one of our firefighters has been selected by the officer staff to be recognized by for our division. And their selection was firefighter Larry Trusty.
When is that taking place again?
May 24th at 11 o'clock.
24th.
At the Rotary Club.
And the public's invited for that?
As far as I know, they are, sir.
Yes.
Can I be your guest that day?
I'm sorry?
Can I be your guest that day?
Surely can.
Anything else, Mr. McLaughlin? Counsel? Chief, I just wanted to say the same thing. You've apparently done a great job of leading that fire department and showing the ability to work, you know, as a group and a team and move in the right direction. And everything I ever hear from any of your I can't get the word out.
Firemen.
There's nothing but positive comments, so thank you very much.
We'll have something formal here in a couple weeks because your review's about ready to be done.
All right.
But he's doing fantastic.
Definitely.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And Mr. Bridge, back to you, sir.
Sure. Let me get my spot here. All right, I think we're under informational items. Again, this is on for the third or fourth council meeting in a row, free smoke detectors. It does include installation. There is zero age restriction on that. So if you know anyone, yourself, your neighbor, an elderly friend, or anyone that needs an operable smoke detector in their house that lives within the city limits of New Carlisle, give our fire station a call. We'll come out and install it for you and everything. Do you know off the top of your head, Chief, how many we have left?
We probably have about 75 left.
75 left?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And also included with this packet is also some information. It's short notice, but tomorrow on May 17th at this Greater Springfield Chamber of Commerce in their atrium, and that's address at 20 South Limestone Street, they are having an informational session on what's next for the Tremont City Barrel Field. So if you are interested in going that, please check that out. That is tomorrow. I do believe it goes from 5 to 7 p.m. I'm just going to read this, what it says, so you have a general understanding of what will be discussed. It says community leaders will share updates about the barrel fill and continuing efforts to protect our water while we await the U.S. EPA's next steps for its cleanup plan. Health Commissioner Charles Patterson will speak. The event offered is free of charge and no RSVP is required. Light refreshments will be served by the Sheehan Brothers Vending. Donations will be accepted by People for Safe Water for efforts to promote continued public involvement in this crucial issue. So again, if you have the time to go and voice your opinion and listen, tomorrow, May 17th in Springfield at the Greater Chamber of Commerce Atrium, and that is located at 20 South Limestone Street. I do believe that is all I have for my city manager's report. I'd be happy to entertain any questions.
Council? Okay, thank you, Mr. Bridge. Appreciate the report. Excellent job.
Thank you.
Moving on to comments from the members of the public. Anyone in the audience have any comments or questions tonight?
About what you've been talking about or something else?
Anything in general. If you have anything you'd like to go over, we'd ask you to go to the podium and give us your name and address. And you can talk about anything you'd like.
Only if it's nice, though. You say it's not nice? Who's going to get shot under the bus?
My name is Helen Cook, and I live on 221 North Smith. And all I heard about was the city's losing money over the pool, and that nothing, you know, they're not making any progress, and should they keep the pool open or not. My complaint is you don't advertise it at all. I went to the city. I pay my water bill every month. There was nothing on the pool in, what was it? It says here, March to April, there was nothing on the pool at the city that you could even look at to even check it out. And my gripe is I went to get a pass. Well, I take my grandchildren. I am not going to pay $100 to sit on a bench at the pool, not in the pool, but under the shelter while they swim. Now, to me, that is ridiculous. And okay, so from March to April, the fee was $150. Well, nobody knew about that, and the first sign they went up at the pool was last Wednesday that you could get a pass at the city. And I think you guys complain about it, but you don't do anything to promote it.
Can I take this?
Actually, ma'am, on the dry erase board that you're, when you went to pay your bill, if you look to your right, there's a big dry erase board, and it blatantly says pool passes are advertised on that, and it's been on there pretty much for every month since April. So I think you overlooked that. And they're also on the counters, we have pool flyers and also the pool forms that you have.
Well, that's the first I've seen it.
Sure.
And to me, I don't see why a grandparent has to pay to be in there just to watch their kids.
Well, that's just how the pool passes are sold. They're sold in family passes before. You can't go to Kings Island and just get a general entry ticket without writing rights.
Yeah,
I mean,
but I...
How, as a business, as we're the city, if we sell you a pass and give you $50 off, how are we going to know that you or whoever it is not going to sneak into that pool? You know, we can't just have these special passes so people to go inside and sit.
Did last year.
You can add a grandparents to a pass for $50.
There you go.
That pass is too much money.
Okay.
Anything from too much money.
Also, we also had 3,000 flyers, which is a lot of flyers in my opinion, that went out to all the schools.
Yes, area. And the kids don't bring them home because my daughter even told me they have no information on there about, what did she say? I can't remember what she said, but the information was very vague. And half the kids don't bring the passes home, so you might as well not even send them. You'd be better off putting an ad in the paper, in the New Carlisle paper.
There was an ad in there.
No, there wasn't.
I've got it.
Well, when was it?
I don't have the day, but it's sitting at the house with the rest of my New Carlisle papers that I keep.
Well, you'll have to show it to me, because I keep checking it.
I'm just saying, yeah, we sent out the 3,000 flyers. There's been stuff on the board at the city office. We've been
social media.
We've been doing social media, giving away t-shirts that a t-shirt company donated to us to kind of promote the pool, you know, no cost to us, things of that nature. I mean, I'll take any suggestions you've got, but I mean, I think we've covered every base that we can.
Well, I just think that it needs to be put out in. Okay, you guys complained about it in February, I guess, about the pool, the cost and everything. Well, if it's such a drain on the city, give it back to whoever had it before. They did a profit.
No.
And I don't know who that was or anything.
It's always been the city.
I'm sorry?
It's always been the city, except for the first few years that they opened it.
Because somebody said it was privately owned.
It was. At one time, in 1968 when it opened, it was the Wonder family, and it was called Wonderland. And then another family, I think, took it over. It was called the Dip and Dive, if I remember correct. And then at that time, I think maybe in the late 70s, early 80s, the city had bought it.
But I just think that you need to do more to promote it, and not just in New Carlisle. It's like I go to Tip City every day to exercise. They had a great big bulletin, you know, on the roadside saying pre-season passes for sale. Now, we don't do anything like that. If people who don't live in New Carlisle, how do they know? There's people that I know come from Tip City to swim here because they cannot swim at the Tip City pool because it's so crowded.
Right.
I mean, you know, I just think it needs to be more to the public, seen more, advertised more. And I think it's ridiculous for a grandparent to have to pay to sit there on the bench.
Thank you, sir.
Last year,
excuse me just a second, sir. Do you need his name?
Yeah. What was your name, ma'am? What was her name?
Ellen
Cook. Wait a minute.
Do you have an appointment?
Yeah. Do we need to keep that appointment? Did you cover everything you had? Just need to cover him. Are you good?
This is Ms. Albany.
Okay.
Gene, do you need his name or do you want to get, can you go to the podium, sir, please?
Well, I'm
just
going to make a comment.
Okay.
You know, last year we bought the grandkids and daughter and son-in-law a pool vest.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know how many times I went down there, and my wife went down there, but we had a bottle of water, we spray the air book, we went to the shelter house over there while they swam.
Mm-hmm.
All I'm saying is, I am not going to buy a pool pass to go down there and sit.
Right.
That's crazy.
But you got to look at it from our point. I mean, how are we going to... how are we going to know that, and I'm not saying you would, I'm just saying that someone else is going to say, okay, hey, I'm here too, and I'm not mocking, I'm just saying in general, someone's going to say, well, I'm here with my grandkids, I'm not going to swim. 10 minutes later, you may see them in the pool. I mean, how are we supposed to monitor something like that? That can be very time consuming, expensive in its own.
Let me be honest with you, and we're such short staffs, sir, but our lifeguards, their eyes need to be on that pool. I mean, that's what they're focused on.
I agree. Sure. While I had the same policy in place last year, the year before, it wasn't.
What policy?
What policy?
That I have to pay to get in to watch my grandkids swim. Set them in the shelter.
I don't have much of the history of the pool. My understanding, it's been like that for a long time.
Right. Can I answer? Mr. McLaughlin?
Did you not say, sir, a moment ago that you bought a family pass?
That's for our kids.
But were you not able to use that family pass to go in?
You have nothing to show for
it. Well, that's what I'm getting at. If you buy a family pass and your children are not there, but your grandchildren are, could you not come in on that pass and you're not even getting in the pool, you just said? No, is that what you did last year?
But well, that's illegal. There's nothing, you get nothing, no pass or anything.
No, I understand what you're saying.
They never asked me if I had a pass. I just, my grandkids went to Trevor or Hayden and Jeff. They didn't ask me who didn't ask me no more.
Well, I would think if you have a family pass.
No, I mean, if you have a family pass, it's the people who bought that family pass. You just can't give my pass to Bill and say, here, go use my pass. I mean, it's at the end of the day, that pool's
no, not a, not a physical pass. I mean,
I see what you're saying. I mean, at the end of the day, the pool's a business, and we have to run it as such.
But you could also pay to go in if you wanted to. A day pass.
Yeah, you can pay a daily gate fee to go in for $7.
You could do a gate fee.
When I paid you $175, I could have paid $150 if I knew it was available. I believe it's still in the
pass. Yeah, but if you bought a pass this year, you should have paid $150 for it up until the end of this month.
I'm only going to pay $25 extra, but no more than that.
Well, the fees are set, so unfortunately, that's just how it is.
Right there. You're going to lose it. The woman who came in with me, she says, I agree with you.
Well, I mean, at some point in time, and like I said, controlling who's in there with a swimming pass and not in a swimming pass, we don't have the staff to do that. At the end of the day, I mean, I'll look around other municipal pools. If they have something, which I'll be shocked if they do. But at the end of the day, that pool's a business, and we sell passes accordingly. The goal is for that pool to make money. If we go in and chop things down so somebody can go watch their grandkids swim, I think we're just going to get into a lot of muddy area that's going to be out of control very shortly.
Thank you. Nancy.
My name's Nancy Livanovich, 505 Pease Drive. I fully understand the lady's frustration because I went through it when my grandkids were here. I do believe I volunteered at a place that helped people, and what they did was issue a little card, okay? If you have that little card, you were allowed to go in there. I don't see why we can't do something like that, and if they have that card, put a ribbon on them, and that they're not going to go in swimming because they have this ribbon. If it's a different color, you can go in swimming. Now, the ribbons don't cost a lot, and rather than lose possible consumers to our pool or visitors to our pool, I think we need to find a way to get around this because our grandparents, of which I'm one, are getting reamed all over the place anyway on stuff. So I think we need to find a way, and I would expect to hear a solution from you guys next week or next meeting. Okay?
Nancy, if you don't mind me asking, do you know of, I mean, or either group, do you guys know of any other pools that do something similar? Any, I don't care if it's
Tipton City do anything similar?
No.
So you mentioned
it's going to be tough.
You mentioned Huber.
Here,
well, what about Huber? Does Huber do anything?
There isn't a lot of pools now. You know,
right.
They don't.
Most of them are a lot of perks.
Band-Aid or wrap?
And that ribbon, anybody can rip that thing off their wrist in 2 seconds.
I don't think these grandparents are in that position.
I'm not saying, Nancy, I have seen people pull over stuff you'd not think people would do it. Sure.
Okay, since Howie's not here tonight, and even though I will say it's, I mean, the season starts in 2 weeks.
Yeah, there'd be no fix for this year. I'll be honest, and this is no disrespect, but this is an administration decision, not a council decision.
Right.
So council would not be able to sway the administration to do something because it falls on the operations of the city. I have no problem looking at how to fix this, but for this year, I just don't see that fix because we open up. I wish you would have came to us probably a month earlier.
No, you would have heard that.
Yeah,
okay,
so.
Well, Brandon, and you're right. This is totally your guys' decision.
Yeah.
But at least, let's, you know, at your end and in my end, I'd like to at least go home and start looking and seeing what else, what possibly other pools and parks are doing something similar. See if maybe something could be done.
Maybe we have a grandparent pass. It's like 30, 40 bucks, and that just
maybe,
gets in.
Maybe, less.
But the requirement is you have to be in jeans and a sweater.
Who would be the administration that we would need to talk to?
Mr. Bridge.
He's the boss. Okay.
I mean, and just because nobody else is doing doesn't mean we can't figure something out. But you just, my goal is to preserve that pool and any penny it's going to make profit-wise. I understand your concern. I really do. I get it. But again, for this year, it's going to be a tough change. It really is.
I have lost
$50 for a grandparent's pass. Now, that's a grandparent's pass that can. Is that grandma and grandpa or just grandpa? Because it's 25 for grandma, 25 for grandma. So we'll come to a good conclusion. It's just, it's going to be timing is what it's going to be. And this year is going to be tough.
Mr. Cobb.
It's about the publication that's already around. That's all
about. Ronald Cobb, 202 Bell Drive. On the pool pass. I wasn't going to say that, but I got worked up here now. On the pool pass.
Poking the bear.
Does a person that lives outside the city limits pay the same as a person that lives in the city limits?
They sure do.
That's not right.
That's right.
Because my general taxes go in to support that pool. The person that lives outside the city should pay more than what I pay.
Okay. I agree with you.
You know, because I'm also out of my personal taxes that go to the city help pay the operation of that pool. I don't think it's fair that they should pay the same price I pay. Mm-hmm. Now, like I said, I wasn't going to say that, but you got me worked up now. And I'm ready to close the pool down.
Close the pool and have another empty building.
Pardon?
Close the pool and have another empty building.
Oh, no, when I get done with it, we're going to level the building and fill the hole in.
When you find the money, let me know.
Well, I have the petition going for it.
Raise taxes for it.
Mr. Reynolds.
To Mr. and Mrs. Cook, I have a quick question. Do you guys, when you guys go to the pool, do you guys buy snacks and stuff for the kids?
They buy.
I'm assuming, they buy that type of stuff?
Yeah,
exactly. I mean, I'm going to be honest. I think we have to develop something.
I'm all for it. I'm
like,
all for it.
If it's a band or something, I think that's an amazing idea because they might not be swimming in the pool, but they're taking their kids there who are purchasing things in the pool, whether it be hot dogs or nachos or candy or whatever it is. So that
Well, you just got to be careful how you do this because we have a lot of grandparents here, and sooner enough or later, we can't have 25 grandparents in the back because they're still going to have to be watched. They're still on city property. You know, if one of them falls and trips getting to their grandkids walking across the grass, there are so many things that come into play.
I am willing to work with you guys.
So then if we don't want grandparents there, we just shut down the whole thing and say, oh, well, because you're getting too
old. Because you're getting too old. Because there's a grant. No, I have to, you're going to yield because I have the time now.
Okay.
I have, no, here's you gave
deal.
Me time. You're going to yield.
Here's
you are going to yield. I have the time.
Here's the deal.
No, Mr. Mayor, I'm sorry, but you gave me the time, so I want to speak. But
here's
please,
the deal.
No, the point is,
if
of all
this was
of this,
something that would be done, every pool would do it. And you don't...
Has this ever been brought up before to any pool? No, we haven't heard about this. I've been on council for 5 years, and this is the first time I've ever heard of this. And thanks for bringing it up. I mean, there's an option here that we can do something to compromise.
Everybody take a deep breath. I have no problem working with it. I don't have an issue doing this.
And that's what we're saying.
Right now, this amount of time before we open, it's not going to happen this year. We have already put newspaper articles out. We already got the cost of the grandparents permit is out. You'd have come to me a month earlier, we would not be in this situation. Now, you were there last year, so I'm not pointing any fingers back to anyone, but you know it was an issue last year, so somebody could have came to us at the end of last year.
Right.
You know, so I have no issue with doing that.
Didn't know anything about this grandparent thing.
Well, you said you went last year, right? So again, no, we have no problem helping you guys out and trying to find a way.
Last year, we brought family pass for our daughter, son-in-law, and two grandkids.
Mm-hmm.
We got them off when it was closed, and we went to the shelter.
I'll be honest with you, sir. Last year you got a good deal because you were not supposed to use that pass to even get in at all. So I'm just saying, last year you got a good deal. You essentially got in the pool for free all last year. You know, the pool debate's already been done and over with. You know, it was a very stressful situation for just about everybody in this line right here. Again, for the 13th time today, I have no problem working with you for next year. This year is going to be tough. That's all I'm saying.
Mr. McIntyre, before your arm gets too
tired. Yeah, I'm going to do my best Dick Zambach here and try to find a good compromise. I see what Mr. Bridge is saying. I see what everyone here is saying. We're upset about prices, whether that would be somebody from outside the city limits paying the same amount that somebody whose taxes subsidize the pool, or someone just going in to sit and watch and not actually go into the water, having to pay the same rate as a swimmer. These are all great issues that we need to bring up. These are all things that I think we wish we would have seen earlier, as Mr. Bridge noted. These are things we can work on. The issue is that we've already sold, I believe, some pool passes. We've already advertised prices for pool passes. We've been already selling and advertising. And so if we were to change the rules tonight, then we'd have to, in good faith, go back to every other person that we already told, here's the price, here we sold it, and we'd have to reimburse them, we'd have to work with that. These things are not really set in stone, but it's as close as you can get to being set in stone. So now, coming into this pool season, we realize, hey, there's stuff we still need to work on, and I'm really glad that you came here and told us these concerns, because they're things that we hadn't thought of in our lengthy pool debates. Mm-hmm. So I'd love it if you could continue to work with us, and we can find some solutions to make sure that when we go back and revisit the pool and look at the pool, we can take these suggestions, put them into place to have a better pool in the city of New Carlisle.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Lindsay.
Since we're talking about the pool, I'm going to ask a hot button question to Mrs. Harris.
We don't know yet.
We don't know what?
If you're asking about the money, how much it's lost or earned, we have no clue.
I was going to ask her how much she has wrote checks for. Zero? Wow.
I think there's some utilities that are coming in and a little bit of the chemicals are coming
So the chlorine we have that's sitting there is from last year?
No, but they just delivered.
They haven't built it for
it. I haven't gotten invoices yet. We did bring in a little over 3,000 so far for some memberships. I do have that figure.
Really?
But that's from last month's revenue. That's April. And we're already mostly into May. I don't have those figures yet until we get everything put in. So next month I'll start getting a little more detail of the pool revenue and expenses.
We've already had $3,000 in like passes?
For the month of April.
For April already?
I don't
already?
Have any figures for May yet.
Plus the GoFundMe page that brought in just under over $2,200. It's earmarked, but I'm saying
it's... Right, and with donations, it's come in through checks from businesses.
Yes. Now, is that on a separate line item? I didn't notice that in anything for the Gomi Fund, or is that just put into the pool?
It's in the pool.
Allotment?
It'll be in the pool, and the pool report I'll break down when it starts opening up next month.
Okay.
But it's included in our general fund right now.
I was just curious if you had any figures out the top of your head. But yeah, $3,000, I don't know, is that normal for April, for?
They just started selling them, so it's.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a lot of money, a lot of passes.
Yeah, but $150,000.
Nancy?
The mothers that bring the toddlers in the toddler pool, do they have to pay also?
Anytime you walk through the gate using the pool, you should have to pay for it.
I will be calling every swimming pool within a mile, 200-mile radius, find out what they're doing, if they have any clues that they're using, so I'll be back.
Make sure you let us know.
Now, the toddlers, though, I can't remember the age, I think if they're under 4 or 5 and under, they're free.
Yeah.
So essentially, if you were bringing in one of your grandkids that was 5 and under, you're just paying $6 for yourself to come in, or 5.
I mean, you guys understand, this is one department that we can't afford to get breaks on.
Right.
I mean, it's the one that needs every penny accounted for. You know, I mean, it's simple as that. I mean, it's a business.
We know about
sure.
Pennies, mm-hmm. You know, we're just trying to find a way to make it feasible for everybody to enjoy our pool. And the more people that enjoy it, the more money we make of it.
Well, the more people enjoy it, you gotta hire more staff too, because you gotta have a number of guards. So, like I said, there's a balance there. But we can work together, get something figured out. But it's not gonna be the cost of the city. The city's not gonna go in a hole, so certain people can go because they can't, don't wanna bypass. At the end of the day. Sure. Sure. Absolutely.
Can I make
a Nancy, any other questions?
Ms. Harris.
Ms. Harris.
Just for Mr. Lindsay,
yes,
on the second page of the finance report is the revenue.
Yes.
And Fund 505 is your pool. It has a month to date and a year to date, so that's for April. And then the third page is the expenditures. And look under Fund 505, and that'll show our expense to date as of this April report.
Yeah, I thought it was only showing like 700, less than 800 bucks.
Yeah, it shows the total. We'll start getting more detail as we get into it. But that's what it's spent so far.
Okay, thank you, ma'am.
You're welcome.
Anyone else?
No.
All right, let's move on.
We're good.
Committee reports.
I didn't scratch yet.
Committee reports.
None.
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 Let's move on to ordinances. Mr. Collier, whenever you're ready.
Ordinance 16-15, public hearing action tonight, an ordinance authorizing the disposal of unproductive city property.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Reynolds.
Move we adopt ordinance 16-15.
Second.
Ethan, Mr. Reynolds, I'm sorry, you're first.
Yes.
Okay. And then who was second?
Mr. Lindsay.
Mr. Lindsay.
And an explanation to this ordinance. Here we are, guys. The culminating Twin Creeks. This has been a very long process. Longer, I think, for some of you sitting right behind the council there, and some citizens in the audience. I came along in April. This is one of my one things I wanted to get done. This is something that I've taken dear to my heart to try to get done. Madison School's the next one, and then Kennedy Trust is the one after that. Right in front of you, have an ordinance to get rid of 27 unproductive parcels in Twin Creeks. Once we sell these, if it's approved by council, the proceeds from the sale, $189,000, will go towards the debt itself. There is no other function that I can find that is going to be best suited than to pay down the debt. Currently, as we stand, the balance is $675,000. Once we put the $189,000 to that, that brings it down to about $486,000. Once we have that balance down to $486,000, we will then refinance. November 1st, we are eligible to refinance our interest rate. So we will refinance and get a much lower interest rate than 6.125%. So there's two things that's gonna happen with, well, actually more than two things, three things, four things. One, we're getting rid of parcels of land that have no houses on them. There is no
benefit to having a vacant parcel of land in your city. We need a house on there, we need people in it making money, and in return, supporting our income tax. Another thing is, the big thing with this is the debt payment on a year in, year out is $86,000 a year that we have to pay. Now, we get some of that back from people who actually pay their taxes out there, but we usually end up paying about 70 or 72 after we get reimbursed from the assessment that's already out there. But the big thing with this is selling the parcels, moving forward, reducing our debt, refinancing to get a lower payment. If you have any questions on it, I'll be happy to answer them for you.
Mr. Wendy.
Okay. You said you're going to refinance this in November 1st, we'd be eligible.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have any idea what that interest rate could possibly be in November? Have you talked to anybody?
I think the current is 3 to 4%, but do not quote me on that.
It's 3 to 4%, you think?
That's not going right now. And that was through bond counsel when I was down at our attorney's office going through Kennedy Trust litigation strategies. And we had reviewed this, and that's when he had brought up that we are eligible to refi in November 2016.
When this is refinanced, will it be on a fixed rate with a time limit to get it paid off?
That's all still unknown.
I mean, is that what you're looking at to do?
Or I'm going to do the, yeah, probably.
Okay. All right. Thank you, sir.
Sure.
Mr. Owens.
I just want to say thank you. I'm very excited to see us selling these things and then paying down our debt. I know we discussed this for 3 years, at least 4 years since we've been on here, constantly going back and forth, and now it's finally getting cleared up. And I think something we all agree on is paying down our debt and honoring our commitments. And that's incredibly good news. So
it is
definitely one of the, I would say, my proudest moments of this city right here is to pay down our debt and do it in a way that we haven't done in a very long time. We're selling something and doing something with the money that it was intended to do in the first place. So I'm very excited about this. So thank you, sir.
Mr. McIntyre.
Thanks to all your hard work and the hard work of your staff for getting this done. It's something that, you know the whole story. We've been trying for a long time. You guys got it done. Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Mr. McLaughlin. I want to say the same thing. Thank you. This has been an ongoing forever, to be quite honest with you. I hope we see houses on there as soon as possible from the developer. Hopefully we'll get people to put them, people that can afford to buy them, and we'll pay the taxes and go forward. So thanks for all your hard work.
No problem.
Let's look to go forward now.
One of the quick, before you guys go, but one of the questions I had asked quite numerally, not only from council members, but a few citizens as well, the abatements, the assessments are gone. The parcels that we're selling, those abatements, the assessments will never go back on. So we're still responsible to make that payment. So it's not like somebody's going to go buy one of these lots from that gentleman, and then all of a sudden they're gonna start paying their $750 a year assessments. They're gone. So unfortunately for those who have been paying it out there, I know one of our council members is one of those individuals, they'll continue on paying that until 2026. But again, it's fair for some people, it's not fair for others, but as a city as a whole, it's the most viable step that we have right now.
Thank you, sir.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Mr. Scott.
The 27 lot, Brandon, is that full value of each lot?
No.
What do you believe on that?
These were appraised for a bulk purchase. These were appraised for a bulk purchase. If we were going to retain each one of those and sell them individually, you can probably get about $10,000 to $12,000 off of them. Now there's a problem with that, and I'm just going to be very honest when I say this: we will have those parcels in our possession for a long time. I'll be honest with you. Sure. We had some questions about: do we sell them as a bulk, or do we retain them and hire a realtor and just sell them piece by piece? I think councils on board too, that our best option is to unload them all at once. We're not in a position to really be a land agent. We need to get rid of them. And again, the goal is to get houses on there. I don't want to say this as being negative, but right now we don't have people knocking down the doors to come live in New Carlisle. And that would be my fear, that if we did not bulk purchase those, again, we would sit on those for a long time. So the best route is hopefully who we sell them to will be able to, he's not going to build 27 houses in a year. That's just how it goes. So I'm sure he'll probably put a couple up a year, sell those, and move the process forward. But we have a chance here to secure $189,000 and reduce our debt and knock it down to under $500,000 and refinance and get a lower interest rate. And I think that's just going to suit us better in the long run.
The 189, which takes care of every lot that we have out there, or the city owns out there, correct?
All the ones that we own.
That we own?
Yes.
That's what I'm saying. Yep. Okay. And then that money's going to go towards paying off your
infrastructure.
Infrastructure debt.
Infrastructure debt. All right, I just had to ask.
No, you're fine.
Council, any other comments, questions? Mr. Collier, whenever you're ready, sir.
Mr. McLaughlin.
Yes.
Mr. Craybaugh.
Yes.
Mayor Lowry.
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre.
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds.
Yes.
Mr. Lindsay.
Yes.
Ordinance passes 6-0.
It is worth a clap.
Thank you. That was a rough one for the past year, I'm not going to lie.
All right. Before we move on to other business, we need to make a motion to excuse Councilman Rick Lowry.
So moved.
Second.
Mr. McLaughlin, then Mr. Reynolds, second.
Ready for the roll? Anybody object?
No.
No object.
We could. Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Mr. McLaughlin?
Yes.
Mr. Craybaugher?
Yes.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Lowry is excused.
Thank you, sir. Moving on to other business. Whenever you're ready, Mr. Collier.
Under other business, the Memorial Day Walk will be Saturday, May 28th. It will start at everybody will meet at the IGA at 11:30. The walk begins at noon and proceeds down to the New Carlisle Cemetery. The pool opening day will be Saturday, March 28th. It opens at noon. And the city offices will be closed Monday, May 30th for Memorial Day. That's all.
Can I jump in real quick? I'm so sorry.
Mr. Burge.
Memorial Day programs, I just got done today right before I came here. They will be available at the city building tomorrow. This year we're doing an extra ceremony at the end of ours. New Carlisle Historical Society did an awesome job at locating a Revolutionary War soldier that's buried in our cemetery. He did not have his headstone. His name is William Brandenburg. They will be having a separate ceremony after ours to dedicate and unveil his grave marker. There'll be taps played again for the second time and the 21-gun salute. So when you're done with our ceremony, please stop over and see Mr. Brandenburg's and pay respect to a Revolutionary War soldier that's buried in our cemetery.
From what I understand, there are going to be quite a few people in garb of that era also.
Yes.
That'll be nice to see.
Yeah.
Mr. Craywell.
Okay, the last couple of meetings we've been talking about a healthy environment, a healthy city, and one of them is the pool, you know, and that's one of the things that we brought in about the pool. I start on WHIO, might have been this weekend, they were talking about smoking, you know, and they were talking about Clark County, and how we're one of the unhealthiest counties in the state. And we're the 74th. Unhealthy county out 88 here in Ohio. You know, and I was looking up some statistics and it was incredible. Some of the statistics. One of the things that I want to bring up is that when I travel around the United States, I look at the big cities and I see people out riding bicycles, I see people walking. A lot of it's because of traffic and they can't find parking spaces, but the people look healthier, you know. When I go to Washington, D.C., you know, I see people walking in the parks, you know, everywhere. I go to Seattle, I went to a park in Seattle, people are riding bikes and everything. So anyway, I'm just trying to say this. I start looking up some statistics here, and one of the things is that, you know, they're talking about different neighborhoods. You know, the highest areas, you know, that they have unhealthy people. One of them was Fulton Elementary School, and it's Perrin Williams Woods Elementary, Springfield Regional Medical Center. I never had thought the medical center would be one of the unhealthiest places in Clark County. You know, but then the last one they listed was Northern New Carlisle. You know, so. And some of the statistics was, you know, I've shown it to Lowell and I've shown it to Randy. Randy and I got into a discussion about this. And I'm just going to throw this out here real quick and then I'll just let it lie. 67.5% of adults reported being overweight or obese. And it's higher than both the state and national average. Now, remember, we're just talking about Clark County here. 42.3% of high school students, this is really interesting to me, reported being overweight or obese, which is higher than the state and national average. 22.6% of adults reported no physical activity in the last 30 days. They could came in painted the pool. They can come and hoe my garden if they want to. You know, we have a walkway out here, you know, that the people can walk in. We're getting park material, you know, park
playground stuff. Equipment.
Playground equipment. Yeah. Push your grandkids. You know, push your grandkids. Go swimming. This is really kind of really interesting. 21% of middle school students have committed suicide or considered suicide. You know, and that's from a 2015 community health assessment. You know, so we're trying to make a healthy community.
And what we were the first city in Clark County to do what?
Recycle.
No.
To stop smoking in the park.
Restrict smoking.
We were. Totally. We were the first city to start recycling in Clark County.
Oh, really?
Sorry, I wasn't making that up.
I was like,
I don't know about health. Sorry.
You got me confused there for a second.
I wasn't expecting recycling.
I just thought it was neat, though. It is true.
Yeah.
Fun fact of the day.
Get a bicycle out. You know, go to your neighbor's house and go take a walk together. You know, that's the only thing I got to say.
Thank you, sir.
No, I have something. This is not mentioned in the agenda. I know we had obviously discussed the pool, you know, we obviously have different opinions and everything, but I definitely want to say thank you to the members that shown up. I did not go because apparently weather permitting means if it's still drizzling or cloudy, they're going to go out there and do it. So I think the mayor and Mr. Lindsay and Mr. Lowry, and I don't know if you were there, John, or if you two were there, Ms. Lowell, but definitely thank you guys. It looked good. I drove by, so thank you guys so much. Thank you guys. Deserve a round of applause.
I definitely want to thank Mr. Lindsay for showing up because, you know, even though he had voted to open the pool, you're right, but, you know,
my position
Bill does not have the best, you know, hips or knees, and for him to be out there painting was really impressive to see, so definitely big thanks to Bill also.
I wear my jeans.
And, and Wall and Mr. Lindsay here, or Mr. McIntyre, I'm sorry, there's two. They're on the same side. I've both helped out with the pool as well, so big thanks to them.
Hi, Nate. I just want to commend the mayor and his wife for going up to, well, finding out, and then going to Columbus to a country club that was selling lounges for $10 a piece. They were good lounges, and they went up and they bought 32 of them, brought them back, and thank you for that.
I would like to thank our Councilman McLaughlin for donating $100 towards those.
Well, that was no big deal.
Towards those.
It cost more than that to go up there with the trailer and truck to get there. That's true.
Yeah, it was neat, though. I mean, a country club was buying new loungers, and they were selling theirs, which were in really good shape. So actually, the deal was if you bought eight or more, you got them for $7 a piece, and those are probably $90 or $100
lounges.
So we saved a lot of money on buying those. So.
I bought one of those exactly like those 2 years ago, and it was $90-some.
And the country club gave us free tables.
Free tables to go with it.
So I'll be writing a letter of thank you to them for that as soon as I get the information.
Great. Thank you, sir.
Absolutely.
Mr. Carter?
Share something?
Yes, sir.
I passed out this evening to every council member a letter regarding the Heritage Flight Parade. And it's kind of a starting letter that I'm going to start passing out all over the community. And council members, you have yours, so please complete those and give them back to me if you want to be in the parade, or if you're part of an organization that wants to be in a parade, please let them have that. If there's anybody in the audience who is a member of a church or any organization in town that would be interested in participating in the parade, please grab a letter.
The Shriners aren't going to be here, Dennis, correct?
Yes.
Shriners will be.
Yes. So these are going to start showing up all over the community. So if you'd like to have one tonight to take to your church or your organization, please grab one. Get us rolling.
Yeah, Gene's the parade coordinator for the Heritage Flight Festival. He took it over last year for the first time. Did an excellent job. So.
And Andy's my bouncer back here.
Okay.
He's the enforcer.
All right. Any other questions before we end the night? Anyone?
Mr. Mayor,
Mr. Reynolds.
I move we adjourn.